I'm here to speak broadly about the new government and this extraordinary scale of change that is sweeping this town, and to speak briefly, not as an expert on your issues or as an advocate for the nuclear industry, but as a friendly observer on the opportunities and challenges facing your industry in this new context. There's a lot going on in Ottawa lately, perhaps you've noticed. I should have noticed it about 5 years ago. It was a nice summer afternoon in Ottawa. I was in the Byward Market. For those of you from out of town, that's the kind of touristy heritage district with a lot of bars and patios and stuff like that. I was walking down the street, minding my own business, past an outdoor terrace, and a bunch of the people who were out there enjoying a beer or a sangria, I suddenly noticed they were all staring in my direction. And that as I walked further down the sidewalk, all these folks were still staring in my direction. And I thought, well, what a thoughtful and discerning bunch of people are out enjoying a beverage this evening in Ottawa. Perhaps they've seen me in one of my many television appearances or have read one of my thoughtful and quickly written analyses. And then all these folks were kind of over here to my right, and I looked to my left and I realized that Justin Trudeau was walking next to me. And all these people were probably saying, when is that guy going to get out of the way so I could see Justin? Anyway, after that, many things happened. There was an election last year. We at Maclean's were busy organizing a televised debate almost as a kind of a lark. We thought, well, let's have all the leaders come and address the issues, and a print guy can ask the questions, and maybe we'll get a different set of responses than when a TV guy does. And then again, we should have known something was happening. It was scheduled for the first week of August, which everyone thought we were insane because it was going to be weeks, almost months before the campaign started. We're going to have a televised debate in the dead of summer. And then we got the agreement of most of the parties. The Liberals were very nervous and very reluctant to join in. And then we started to negotiate details. We sat down with people. We had site visits so that people from the Prime Minister's office, at the time the Prime Minister was a fellow named Harper, could come and visit the city TV studios and see whether they liked it. And so several days before our debate, one of the people working for Prime Minister Harper said to my producer for this event, okay, this looks really good, but we're a little worried about parking outside. We need to be able to park two buses, one for the Prime Minister and his campaign staff and one for media. And then we realized that the debate was actually going to be the first semi-official event of the campaign rather than beginning 6 weeks before the campaign started. Suddenly the stakes were quite a bit higher. And as you can tell perhaps from just looking at me, I'm a print guy and I don't handle TV lights and pressure as well as some of our Mansbridges and LaFlammes might. But I did my best and we practiced. I thought we had a good event. There were three breaks over the course of the event during which we decided, no reason not to allow the various party leaders to have advisors come in and huddle with them as we move from one segment of the debate to the other. I was fascinated to note that Stephen Harper's advisor during these debates was his son Ben, who is a freshman at Queen's University, varsity volleyball player. Justin Trudeau went a little bit more traditionally. He had the man who's now his principal secretary, Gerald Butts, come in and speak with him. But during the first break, which lasted only 3 minutes, he pulled himself away from Jerry Butts. He came over to me and at my little moderator's desk, and he leaned in and he said, remember to breathe. And I remembered that was an option. And the rest of the debate went a lot better. For me, and there's a school of thought that believes it went a lot better for the man who became the new prime minister. The scale of change in Ottawa has been sweeping, and it began with what happened 6 weeks after that on October, or 16 weeks or whenever it was, on October 19th, when Canadians inflicted quite a substantial scale of change on the country. It was the first time that a majority government has been replaced by another majority government in 23 years since the conservative government of Brian Mulroney and briefly of Kim Campbell was replaced by the Liberal government of Jean Chrétien in 1993, a year before I started this gig as a political reporter. The last time before that was 1984, when the Liberals of Pierre Trudeau and John Turner were replaced by Brian Mulroney's Conservatives. And the last time that a majority was replaced with a majority before that was in 1935, when R.B. Bennett ran out of luck and Mackenzie King came back to the job that was to some extent created for him, that of longest serving prime minister ever. Usually a majority starts to run out of steam and it slips to a minority, and then, as happened with Harper, a conservative minority comes in and replaces a liberal minority, and everyone's a little tentative and nervous and no one's really sure what's going to happen. And that has an effect on how governments operate. Harper's first years as prime minister were very tentative, or rather they were very focused. He introduced that 2-point GST cut in two installments. He increased transfers to the provinces under the rubric of fixing the fiscal imbalance. And he sent out those $100 checks for choice in childcare, which you receive today if you have any children under 6 years old. Although the Liberals are in the business of tweaking that and modifying it, but the program as such was introduced quickly by Stephen Harper almost as soon as he could after the 2006 election. He had a goal in mind. First of all, he was quite sure he would not last very long. They were very worried that Paul Martin would unretire himself and come back to run against them in a very quick snap election. They didn't think it was as likely, but they were even more worried that Jean Chrétien would unretire himself and come back and run against Stephen Harper. And so they figured they had about 7 or 8 months to have anything to show for themselves in government. And so they moved as quickly as they could. He assumed he would only have a few months before facing an election, and he had a tactical goal. He understood that conservatives were outnumbered by the opposition and that the entire opposition was to the left of the conservatives, that there was a coherent alternative government facing him every day in the House of Commons if they ever got their act together. So his tactical goal was keep that large opposition off balance, hence the secrecy, the bullying in parliamentary debate and in parliamentary committees, hence the ferocious message control, which meant that no conservative MP, eventually no member of the bureaucracy, no member of the diplomatic corps was allowed to speak without clearing their message with the prime minister's office first. These were to some extent reflections of the former prime minister's personality, but they were also tactical and strategic choices. Of a kind that this new government has not had to make because it comes into office so comfortable in the number of seats that it has. Even Jean Chrétien's early moves, and now we're getting into ancient history, were quite cautious. He did cancel the military helicopter purchase that Mulroney and Campbell had planned. He canceled the privatization of Pearson Airport and bought the government many years in court after that for their efforts. And he did spend a then-controversial $6 billion on an infrastructure program. And then he kind of waited and planned and consulted for a while. That government really didn't take any further strong action until its second budget, more than a year down the road. This year, we are already seeing that things are different. Justin Trudeau's mandate and his action have been quite sweeping, sometimes breathtakingly so. A sampler from among the actions of the first 3 months. He appointed a gender-balanced cabinet because it was and remains 2015. He accelerated the intake of Syrian refugees in a way that was, you know, a little raggedy at first, but has picked up steam and momentum and become something that all Canadians are buying into and trying to ensure as a success. He appointed a new ambassador to the U.S. He restored the mandatory long-form census, which Harper hadn't bothered to eliminate until he'd been here for 4 years. So Harper got rid of the mandatory long-form census only after his second election. Justin Trudeau restored the mandatory long-form census just as soon as he could. He implemented this middle-class tax cut. He took all of the premiers to the Paris Climate Conference. He worked towards establishing this inquiry into the missing and murdered Indigenous women. He brought the CF-18s home from Iraq. He has launched a defense policy review with a mandate to report by the end of the year. He's appointed an economic prosperity panel headed by Dominic Barton, the head of McKinsey Canada. He's put another panel in charge of proposing new senators, released public mandate letters for all of his cabinet ministers. He invited my friend Peter Mansbridge to ride on the bus to the cabinet swearing in. The old Stephen Leacock line, the gentleman who jumped onto his horse and rode madly off in all directions. Although, for the most part, this government tends to be riding madly off in one direction, according to an agenda, but it is still a bit of a challenge for a small news bureau like Maclean's to cover, and I think probably a challenge for Canadians to keep up with. A lot of what he's doing is symbolism. And it's important not to exaggerate the importance of symbolism. But if symbolism didn't count, then Stephen Harper would not have spent so much time putting the color blue on government websites, renaming government buildings after historic conservatives, or elevating Tim Hortons to nearly the level of a state religion. Symbolism does have value. And much of what this new government has done has not been only symbolic. The decision to go deep into deficit was partly something they brandished to show that they were a different kind of opposition party from the NDP. But it also amounts to a bet that infrastructure is best built on dollars borrowed at low interest, and that in a period of low resource prices and economic doldrums, it is best to err on the high side when borrowing. This, incidentally, happens to be Stephen Harper's nightmare. A government like this is the thing that he worked very hard to assure would not be elected. He had hoped to lock in a long-standing prejudice in favor of limited government by reducing federal revenues with popular tax cuts so that no left-leaning government could dare undo those cuts in the future. His goal was to make his reforms proof against a future conservative election loss by discouraging a government of a different stripe from reversing those reforms. And it kind of worked. It substantially forced the opposition leader, Tom Mulcair, to promise balanced budgets and program changes that would, in most cases, have been measured over many years, would have taken many years to implement. He did produce a cautious opposition. Unfortunately, there was another one. And Trudeau rejected the premises that Harper had tried to impose. This government plans to be active. It plans to be expensive. It plans to be easy to scrutinize. And it is unworried, at least so far in its early days, by any perceived need to balance its budgets. This government is as defiantly progressive as its predecessor was defiantly defiant. Half of its ministers are women. Nearly all of them wore pink yesterday to discourage bullying. They tweet their concern about their white privilege and their discussions with their kids about these issues. They are, by every poll I've seen, more popular today than they were when they ended Stephen Harper's political career. Even some of the things that they're doing that seem symbolic are not really symbolic, or at least they're not only symbolic. Meeting the premiers reinforces an impression of openness. It gives you the sense that this prime minister is happy to talk to anyone. But it also necessarily expands the circle of decision makers on key budgeting decisions at the federal level. And it tends to generate ideas for new things governments can do. First ministers' meetings are almost inevitably vehicles for larger, more activist government. That's why Stephen Harper didn't want to meet the premiers. He liked his decision-making circle as tight as possible, and he was mostly in the market for things that governments could stop doing. He knew that if he invited the premiers to Ottawa, very few of them would suggest that he stop doing things, and so he didn't invite them. Those public mandate letters are an interesting component of all of this. Prime ministers always send mandate letters to their ministers. That's how the ministers know what their brief is going to be for the time that they have a department under their stewardship. Those letters at the federal level have never been made public before. That secrecy was never a scandal before. It was never even particularly remarked on before. And for the most part, I've been told that if you could read the mandate letters that ministers received from Brian Mulroney or Jean Chrétien or Stephen Harper, very little in them would even have surprised you. Dear Justice Minister, as Minister of Justice, I expect you to look after the Justice Department. That's kind of the way of these things. But the public mandate letters are not sham transparency or gimmicky transparency. They were made public to put the ministers on notice. This is what you're expected to do. We want everyone in the country who cares, wants to find out, to know what it is you're expected to do, and you will be judged periodically over time on whether you do it. This matters. If there's a management guru who has guided the thinking of Trudeau's government in the early days, it is a fellow named Sir Michael Barber, who helped implement education reforms during Tony Blair's first term in government at the end of the 90s as Prime Minister in the United Kingdom. During Blair's second mandate, Michael Barber became the Prime Minister's chief advisor on delivery. He was charged with achieving similar results across government. And since then, Barber has become a worldwide consultant who travels around to India and the United States and Canada, helping governments achieve results. He calls his techniques deliverology, and he says that instead of coming up with new ideas all the time, governments should more often be in the business of delivering on the ideas they got elected on. It's an extraordinary thing about politics that this is a novel idea that you could make money off of. In 2004, when Dalton McGuinty was the new Premier of Ontario, and he wanted to make a big difference in the province's schools, his chief of staff, a fellow named Gerald Butts, who would become the Prime Minister's principal secretary, spent a month following Michael Barber around London, an extraordinary investment of a senior advisor's time at a time when, on any day, if Jerry had stayed in Toronto, that he certainly would have been kept busy. But he went and he spent a month following this guy around London to see what he did. And then Michael Barber came to advise the McGuinty government, and they've stayed in touch ever since. And Michael Barber was the main attraction when Trudeau's cabinet held a three-day cabinet retreat in New Brunswick 2 months ago. He's already been back even since then to advise senior bureaucrats on his methods and ideas. Barber's thesis is that citizens' faith in government depends on governments being able to achieve their goals, and that constant attention and broadly available data are needed if those goals are to be reached. Everything has to be online. Everything has to be able to be consulted by regular folks. That's why Trudeau's Cabinet Committee on Agenda and Results, a new name for a committee that in this form had never existed before in the federal government, is chaired by the Prime Minister himself. I assume that the meetings of the Agenda and Results Committee will be essentially terrifying for any minister who gets called before it. It's like a nonstop series of parent-teacher meetings. And it's why Matthew Mendelson, a close Trudeau associate from a think tank and NGO in Ontario, has moved from Toronto to Ottawa to become the new Deputy Secretary to Cabinet for Delivery. This kind of talk, agenda, delivery, results, really turns the new Prime Minister's crank. A year ago, at a meeting of the Canada 2020 think tank here in Ottawa, the then leader of the third party, Justin Trudeau, interviewed Martin O'Malley, who was the former Baltimore mayor, Maryland government, who later ran briefly and unsuccessfully for the Democratic presidential nomination. There was no room for Governor O'Malley in this year's presidential race because he's quiet and thoughtful. All of these people who gravitate to these ideas believe that success lies in selecting the right targets, publicly stating them, and being willing to take the flak if you don't hit them. As a Trudeau advisor told me when they were explaining all this to me, they said, this is not some touchy-feely, love people, hug everybody thing that we did. Although, as you may have noticed, they're not actually averse to touchy-feely, love people, hug everybody things. They're doing this, they said, because they think it actually works. Now, this system, with its strong emphasis on delivery of widely known objectives, is also important for anyone who wants to influence government decisions. Already, the first question coming from every minister's office when a company or association goes knocking on their door is, okay, this great, this thing that you're talking to me about, this thing that you think that we should do, is it in my mandate letter? If it isn't, then it's a positive waste of time for the minister to spend much time dealing with it, because the stuff that is in their mandate letter is lengthy and will be hard to deliver, and they're going to be checked on it. People I talk to around Ottawa say they are surprised how difficult it is to push their projects onto the government agenda if they cannot purport that it is in the minister's mandate letter. And in case my point is not yet clear enough, I was not able to find references to nuclear energy in any minister's mandate letter. Now, as we have just heard, at what I expect for you is gratifying length, there are slots into which nuclear energy can be made to fit, and they're not trivial. Jim Carr's letter as Minister of Natural Resources contains references to a strategy to protect Canada's energy security, to energy conservation, and to cleaner renewable energy and a smarter electricity grid. Now, you know better than I do that there are ways to interpret nuclear energy as fitting into any of those rubrics. But there is no positive call for greater use of nuclear energy in that letter or any other minister's. Now, I asked somebody who works with the Prime Minister what kind of future nuclear energy might have under a Trudeau government. And I was told the future for the nuclear industry in Canada is as bright a one as they can make a case for economically. Does this government have an a priori opposition to nuclear as a new or expanded energy source? No, not at all, I was told. We would not oppose it for sure, this advisor said. Now, the same advisor said most decisions on nuclear power are made at the provincial level, as you know. And the choice of terms is probably important. The case that they are most interested in hearing is essentially an economic case, or a cost of delivering energy case. The cost of delivering the energy matters more than the nature of the energy. This is not, as you've heard, a nuclear-phobic government at all. And you will know better than I do which projects are cost competitive with other forms of energy in which regions. I suspect that in reality, the implicit bar that is set here is actually fairly high. The Canadian nuclear energy has been going through a difficult period. Whether it's cost overruns at Darlington, the indefinite delay in any new build there, the problems at Chalk River, the isotopes crisis, the reputational hit that the industry has taken in recent years is not to be underestimated. Employment in the industry has declined by about a quarter since the turn of the 21st century. Overseas, the Cernavoda plant in Romania has faced repeated delays. R&D and science and technology investment in the industry has been low by the standards of some other industries, undermining its claims to being innovative. And electricity demand in Canada has been fairly flat for many years, limiting the economic case that could be made for a substantial expansion in nuclear. There is another problem, more subtle, but perhaps more difficult to overcome. It's a problem of perception. If you want to see how this government views itself, the causes it wants to be allied with, the vocabulary with which it is comfortable, look at the two global conferences to which the Prime Minister and his staff and colleagues have hurried since the election. First was the World Economic Forum at Davos. And the second, much less known to most of us in Canada, is the Globe Series conference in Vancouver next week, which the Trudeau government has taken steps essentially to nationalize. The Prime Minister will deliver a keynote speech there and then meet the premiers for a First Minister's conference the next day. Now, I looked at the agendas for both Davos and the Globe Series this year, and nuclear energy does not appear as a topic at either event. This will seem a simplistic test, but I'm not sure it is. At Davos, Trudeau mentioned the software engineers that Waterloo University churns out by the hundred. He discussed with Jens Stoltenberg, the Secretary General of NATO, no less, his obligations as a father to raise feminist children. He met with Bono and Kevin Spacey and senior executives from Royal Dutch Shell and Microsoft, General Motors, and Facebook. He had a busy time. They were basically buzzed when they came back from that conference. He didn't discuss nuclear energy as such at any moment during that visit. Much the same series of events will play out next week in Vancouver, and it's even more surprising because Vancouver is a clean energy conference. Let me sum up the picture that I've been painting. Every minister's career in the short term depends on delivering specific obligations spelled out in mandate letters that anyone can read. Those obligations fill every minister's field of vision the way a truck coming at them would, and will for the foreseeable future. And none of the letters mentions nuclear energy. The Prime Minister's entourage expresses no particular eagerness to dismiss nuclear energy, but the stated test of utility for any new activity in nuclear, an economic rationale, is not easily made in the current environment. And when this government goes to the big international get-togethers where it believes the future is being made, it doesn't hear about nuclear energy or meet with industry representatives. Now, all of this would seem to be a problem for you. Now, as I've said, I'm not here as an expert on nuclear energy, far from it, or as an advocate for the nuclear industry. But if I were any group or organization seeking influence with the new federal government in any field, I would seek lessons from what has worked in the past. For this government, the closest parallel from the past is the early days of Jean Chrétien's government, when the economy was unsteady, ambitions were high, demands on the government were greater. In that context, Chrétien eventually decided he wanted to make university research one of his most constant policy ambitions. He was helped by several players in the university sector that were normally antagonistic. Presidents of big universities, student groups, teachers' associations. Most of the drama in campus politics comes from conflict among those groups, over salaries, over budgets, over administrative jurisdictions. But for several years in the mid-90s, those groups put their differences aside to argue in a consistent way and usually with a single voice that university research mattered and could make rapid progress in partnership with the federal government. Instead of taking their problems and their divisions to Ottawa, they presented solutions that would be broadly acceptable across the sector. The Chrétien government bought into that message in a big way, and even though later governments have been less constant in their affection for university research, many of the changes that were made then have lasted. So I would say to the nuclear industry in this country, if you want the attention of the federal government, you must not only seek the attention of the federal government, you don't need to talk up, you need to talk out. I've been in a room with that prime minister, and I can tell you that everyone is trying to get his attention. As a handy first step, if you want to be seen as clean tech, you should get clean tech companies and clean tech organizations to accept you as a peer. If you want to be seen as innovative, you should seek exchanges and partnerships with sectors that are more broadly and commonly seen to be sources of innovation. Start by figuring out how you could be present on the speakers list at Davos or the Globe Series the next time they meet. Come up with concrete clean energy solutions to the biggest problems of this government's agenda. One of the takeaways from next week's First Minister's meeting is certain to be a discussion of how the extractive activities in the resource sector can be made lower carbon emitting. Nuclear reactor in Alberta that provided the steam that could help people extract oil sands oil at much lower carbon cost than current methods would be something that would be seen as extraordinarily interesting by these guys. Forge partnerships with groups that might not be seen as natural allies of the nuclear industry and go together to present these kinds of solutions to the federal government and to Canadians in general.